Van, then just quickly, like today, are there apostles and prophets today in the New Testament?
And you gave me the instruction to say this quickly, right, Rob?
Yeah.
Right. You want me to solve one of the major issues going on in the Pentecostal and charismatic world.
That's quickly. How much I trust you.
Yes, thank you. I think to say it best is that maybe one of the advantages of the Book of Acts is that it doesn't give us a clear structure for how the church is supposed to work.
Mm-hmm.
When the New Testament period closes, the church is still trying to figure out how to make the transition from synagogue to their own churches. They are developing leadership positions. I mean, Paul, the way he speaks, is pastoring churches that he's long been separated from,
mm-hmm.
talking about local elders. So you see a form of authority forming in the early church, but you don't have a pattern. So when the whole issue comes up, are there apostles and prophets today? I think the first thing I would say is there seems to be some room for us to discern what structure will best serve the church at any given point in time.
Okay.
Secondly, I think that you see this is all over the map, and that's why I jumped on you a little bit with quickly.
Yeah.
Pentecostals, PAOC, the denomination I'm involved with, Assemblies of God in the States, have been a bit skittish about saying there are apostles today with a great amount of authority attached with it because of their history. Both came out of situations about 100 years ago, a little less, when they felt no longer welcomed by the authorities in the churches they were attending. So
okay.
Pentecostal revival is starting. And moving out of those churches, they determined that they would not create a hierarchical structure because they associated it with those who had asked them to leave.
Okay.
So Pentecostals, I think, certainly practice the gifts of the Spirit, and they certainly are comfortable with apostle in that more missionary, breaking new ground function, but they've been skittish about using it.
Yeah.
On the other hand, there are some Pentecostal denominations and charismatic ones that feel strongly that we need to restore apostles and prophets for the church to fulfill its mission, and they will gladly use the titles. Often what you see, though, is title or not, in various denominations, select individuals functioning similarly, but without the title.
Okay. Well, you know, that's fair enough. Let me switch gears here. As a teacher in the body of Christ, one of the four or five, what has God sort of laid upon your heart? We talked earlier about Romans chapter 12. Can you sort of segue into Romans chapter 12? We've got about 10 minutes. And just from your heart, what is God saying to you, to the church, according to Romans chapter 12 today?
So Romans 12 is another chapter where the gifts of the Spirit are listed. It's a pivotal point in Romans, and of course this is the great letter of Paul, because he is presenting his gospel to a city that he hopes to go and visit and establish an apostolic base from. So he is writing about the work of God in Christ through the Holy Spirit through the first eight chapters. Then he talks from 9 to 11 about the future of Israel. He is now turning the corner in chapter 12 to what he traditionally does, where he takes the theology he's been developing and says, okay, so this is what the Spirit is saying now in terms of how we live. This text would be familiar to most of those watching tonight. 12:1, therefore I urge you, brothers, and notice, Rob, the way he starts here. In view of God's mercy, now Paul is about to deal with all kinds of issues, behavioral issues, attitudinal issues, but where he starts is, look, whatever I'm going to say to you, this is all based on the grace of God.
Okay.
In other words, in this opening, he's saying, whatever we do is in response to God's grace. Even Christians who have known Jesus for a long time sometimes maybe get a little confused and get thinking that we can be proactive in terms of grace. We can somehow get ahead of God and rack up some grace points. This text gives us the idea that grace always precedes us, so that we're always reacting to God's grace, never earning it, just responding. Okay. It's always been that way. It was that way for Israel. God called them before he gave them the law. He reminded them who he was, that I'm the God who brought you up out of Egypt. And then the law follows, but he presents himself first as, I'm the one who dealt with you in grace. I delivered you. Mm-hmm. So the law is even given in response to God's grace. Mm-hmm. And of course, for believers, we understand that we are serving Jesus because of what he's done for us. So it's all a response. So let me read on. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. So notice a couple things about what he's saying here then. In view of God's mercy then, worship is everything you do, how you live. To use the kind of terminology we hear a lot today, this is without boundaries, this is without limits. Mm-hmm. He says that you are the sacrifice. In the Old Testament, you brought something else. He said you are a living sacrifice. It's not just about what you do in the temple in the Old Testament, in the church. Your life is the sacrifice. So he's saying, in view of what God has done, in view of God's mercy, all of your life is to be a sacrifice. Mm-hmm. Okay, so he has given us a general principle here for the Christian life as a response, always a response. He talks about the renewing of the mind, transforming of the mind in verse 2. Then when he comes to verse 3, the first thing he wants to talk about, he says, now we've talked about the transformed mind, which is the way the Spirit helps us to live this response to God's grace. The first thing he wants to talk about is how we view one another. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, reading from verse 3, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the measure of faith God has given you. So Paul says, I'm saying this by grace. Now you think of it in terms of the faith God has given you. In other words, he couches this in grace. He says, now, when you look at one another, do not look at another person in terms of ranking, in terms of position. Do not consider your particular gifting, your position, as more significant. Do not think more highly of yourself than you ought. And then he moves in to talking about the gifts of the Spirit. He uses the analogy of the body that he likes. He uses it in 1 Corinthians as well, the idea that there are many gifts in the same way that there are many aspects to the human body.
Right.
So he does all of this, and this beautiful text, which will take us into Thanksgiving weekend, he is saying then, what you need to recognize is in the same way God's grace precedes you, you need to continue to live in this grace, such that you give grace to other people to allow them to be as significant as you. And in fact, he said, instead of thinking of yourself more highly in terms of a hierarchy, look at other people as people you need and people who need you. In other words, see yourself as dependent on them and they are dependent on you.
Okay.
In other words, allow the grace of Christ in the same way it comes through Jesus Christ, allow it to come through others. Mm-hmm. And so you have this idea of the gifts of the Spirit couched in grace. So the point of the gifts is not then to create a hierarchy,
right,
to create positions where one is more significant, though different gifts mean different responsibilities and sometimes different positions. Mm-hmm. But Paul says it's all about grace, and these things were given to you, so make sure you give freely of them.
Yeah.
So then he starts listing the specific gifts in 6, 7, and 8, and as I said at the outset of this call, he doesn't really bother to tell us what they are. He just says, if this is your gift, then use it. If that's your gift, then use it. So this has been on my heart lately, both because I continue to be fascinated with how we understand the gifts of the Spirit and what it means for our congregations today. Because there's a vision I still have of the church as a group that would actually take this so seriously that every individual would honestly consider what contribution they would make. And then I'm fascinated with it because Thanksgiving is coming. Mm-hmm. So I think all of this is to say, what if there was a church where each person realized their value, the leadership saw their value, mm-hmm. and everybody made their contribution. Otherwise, we're a church like a hockey team that enters the hockey season. Mm-hmm. Hockey season is starting soon, isn't it? with one goalie when he can make it,
yeah.
or she can make it, a defenseman who's pretty regular, very faithful,
yeah.
and you know, a stunning forward. I mean, the forward is just all over the place.
What it's about, yeah.
Yeah, but what it's about. So it's a vision that yeah. I think we continue to work towards.
Yeah.
And I think whatever church structure we have to ask ourselves, are we preparing people for ministry?
Okay.
And once prepared them, are we giving them the grace in the room to use yeah. the gifts that they have?
Yeah. Now, Van, we've got about a minute and 30 seconds. Let me ask you this question.
Yep.
Do you think we as a church today, I mean, across the board, are actually fulfilling this? Are we far off? What's your perspective?
Some denominations, the way they are structured, give more room for it. But I don't think there's any way to replace local leadership in this.
Yeah.
And I think no matter what the structure, how the local pastor, the local pastoral team, looks at those that they shepherd is so critical here.
Mm-hmm.
You can have it right in your statement of faith in your ecclesiastical structure, mm-hmm. but unless leadership has confidence mm-hmm. to give ministry away, mm-hmm. to actually prepare people for it,
mm-hmm.
and if the people who hear it are confident enough to believe
yeah.
that the leadership is serious, that they actually can do this. I mean, let's be honest, it's not just church leadership.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we appreciate the fact that a leader is saying that they are going to do it for us. He or
yeah.
she is going to do it for us. So it has to go both ways. And so I think it's church to church.
Yeah.
Do we mean it when we say it? And do the people who hear us saying, look, you have a role to play here, do they believe it? So I think it goes both ways, Rob.
Well, now, is there, in about 30 seconds, what's our responsibility? And how do we respond sitting in the pew?
I would think, first thing, I think you do a couple things. I think, first of all, you prayerfully say, Lord, what have you laid on my heart? I think we know the gifts of the Spirit,
mm-hmm.
partly by the prompting of the mm-hmm. Spirit. Secondly, I think we ask those people who know us well, mm-hmm. you recognize this gift in me?
Yeah.
Thirdly, I think then we begin to look for opportunities to begin to learn. And I think we learn the gifts. Mm-hmm. Having a gift doesn't mean that you're proficient in the same way having a hockey skill doesn't mean that you can play
right.
for the Leafs. Well, it may be easier to play for the Leafs. I think then you find a place where you can learn to use your gift
yeah.
and bless Jesus and bless
yeah.
the church.
Wow. Well, Van, thank you so much. I mean, you've given such a wealth of knowledge and excellent teaching, and we're going to pick up on it in just a few moments when we open up the lines. But again, I want to thank you for taking the time to sharing with us on It's Your Call, and definitely we're going to get you back.
Thank you, Rob. Look forward to it.
God bless you. Have a great evening.
Thank you.
Thanks, Van.
Bye now.